नमस्कार, DD1 के दर्शकों का मैं पार्वती लोकसभा के केंद्रीय कक्ष से हार्दिक स्वागत करती हूं। आज यहां हमारे माननीय राष्ट्रपति जी डॉ. शंकर दयाल शर्मा वर्ष 1996 के लिए उत्कृष्ट सांसद पुरस्कार प्रदान करेंगे। आज ये चौथा सम्मान श्री सोमनाथ चटर्जी को प्रदान किया जा रहा है। इससे पहले ये पुरस्कार श्री अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी, श्री चंद्रशेखर और श्री इंद्रजीत गुप्तो को प्रदान किए गए हैं। श्री सोमनाथ चटर्जी 3 दशकों से भारतीय राजनीति से जुड़े हुए हैं। वे एक जाने माने वकील, मजदूर नेता, राजनीति विज्ञानी और मुखर सांसद तो हैं ही, साथ ही वे सभी को प्रिय भी हैं। श्री चटर्जी 25 वर्षों से भी ज्यादा समय से लगातार लोकसभा के सदस्य रहे हैं और ये उनकी लोकप्रियता और कर्मठता का परिचय देते हैं। भारतीय राजनीति को उनके उल्लेखनीय योगदान को देखते हुए ये उचित ही है कि आज श्री चटर्जी को वर्ष 1996 के लिए उत्कृष्ट सांसद पुरस्कार से सम्मानित किया जा रहा है।
Respected Vice President, Honorable Prime Minister, Honorable Deputy Chairperson of Rajya Sabha, Sri Somnath Chatterjee, Honorable Members of Parliament, distinguished guests. It is a matter of great honor and pride for me to be associated with a solemn function to confer on Sri Somnath Chatterjee the Outstanding Parliamentarian Award 1996 of the Indian Parliamentary Group. Inwardly, I have always assigned to Sri Somnath Chatterjee the status of my guru. In 1977, I was a member of the Parliamentary Committee on Subordinate Legislation headed by him. In this capacity, I also traveled around with him in the Northeast. He made me feel that just being with him was education. and assimilating his ideas was intellectual elevation. Public service as parliamentarian and legal practice as a professional are matters of family tradition for Sri Somnath Chatterjee. His father, late N.C. Chatterjee, had also served our nation as a member of parliament and had practiced law in the Apex Court of India as Sri Somnath Dada does now. Though Sri Somnath Chatterjee has had an aristocratic lineage and Western education, including for being a barrister, he embraced communism for his political faith and has been a steadfast practicing communist for about 3 decades. When Sri Somnath Chatterjee joined us in the 11th Lok Sabha, it was for the 7th time that he was returned to this house. This at once speaks volumes for his image among his electors, his standing in his party, and his stature as a parliamentarian and a national leader. Sri Somnath Chatterjee, throughout his parliamentary career, was also naturally sought after on account of his expertise to be chairman and members of many committees. He served with distinction as chairman of the Committee on Subordinate Legislation, as well as Committee of Privileges. He was also a member of several joint committees and select committees, particularly ones requiring requisite expertise in law. As a barrister and as a senior lawyer, he brought his legal acumen to bear with considerable impact on shaping legislation in a diversity of areas, areas of corporate, fiscal and commercial laws, and constitutional and criminal laws. His enlightened advice was also available to the ministries of law, finance and home in parliamentary consultative committees of which he has had occasions to serve. His earlier service as chairman of the departmentally related standing committee on railways and his service currently as chairman of the committee on communication has helped in balanced and constructive scrutiny of performance of these ministries. The government of West Bengal have also understandably secured over the years the benefit of his chairmanship in several state public sector corporations. His debating skill will turn any legislator green with jealousy. His depth of subject knowledge, the diction and propriety of his vocabulary, and elegant humor of his presentation, as I have often seen from the presiding officer's chair, almost invariably makes his political opponents speechless and helpless. When Somnath Chatterjee is on his legs, he demonstrates an incredible awareness of national and international issues simply by emoting from his experience. I was closely following his statement on the floor of the House on the 25th of February 1997 on the motion of thanks to the President's address. In the sweep of his statement, he effortlessly traversed a wide-ranging ground, the rationale of governance through coalition, separation of powers, federalism, secularism, liberalism, national integration, macro and microeconomics, employment situation, poverty alleviation, welfare administration, regional development, and South Asia regional issues. Trade unionism is natural to Bengalis. Combining in himself in Bengali moorings, syndicalism, which he should have imbibed during his youthful days as barrister, and Marxist dialectics. As a practicing communist, he has been an inevitable leader of the working class. He has been giving mature leadership to several major trade unions in West Bengal, of which I had the privilege of observing as a minister for labor for many years. I am also aware that he is now doing his best to harmonize working class aspirations with the dictates of a globalizing and liberalizing world. Nor is Sri Somnath Chatterjee confined to the world of politics, parliament, law and working class. In the state of West Bengal and at the national level, he is associated as president or member with a significant number of organizations rendering service in the areas of civil liberties, academics, arts and sports. This profile is that of a resplendent humanist. Sri Somnath Chatterjee's performance in the conferences of the Inter-Parliamentary Union have always had stunning impact on the international audience. Last year, I had the privilege of getting his support on human rights issues in the IPO conference at Beijing. As the rapporteur on the Committee on Human Rights, his contribution to harmonizing a plethora of amendments from several countries for hammering out a resolution on human rights was widely complimented. In terms of conformity to the rules of procedure and conduct of the business of the House, and of protecting the collective dignity of the House and dignity of the individual parliamentarians, he is a copybook model. The towering personality which Sri Somnath Chatterjee is, literally and figuratively, by accepting the Outstanding Parliamentarian Award of Indian Parliamentary Group for the year 1996, he is indeed honoring every one of us in Parliament, even as he is being honored. He fulfills every parameter stipulated for nomination for parliamentarians for this award. I heartily felicitate him. I wish him long years of public life service to the people of his constituency, to the people of West Bengal, to the parliament and the people of India, and to the international community of parliamentarians. Thank you very much.
He's so kind to me.
No, just
I can sit here. Yeah, yeah. This is all right.
You can speak on this. Thank you. Is that the kitchen?
Revered Rashtrapati ji.
Respected Uparashtrapati ji. Honourable Prime Minister, Honourable Speaker, fellow members of Parliament, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I do not have words adequately to express my feeling of gratitude and my sincere thanks to the Indian Parliamentary Group for the great honour bestowed on me, and I accept the same with all humility and realization of my shortcomings. Honorable Speaker has been kind enough to organize this function, for which I am indebted to him. And I am particularly grateful to revered Rashtrapati Ji and our respected Uparashtrapati Ji and the Honourable Prime Minister for having graced the occasion by their kind presence. If I may say so with all modesty, this is the greatest day in my life. I'm overwhelmed that this rare honour has come to me, considering the fact that the earlier recipients of this award and the similar awards have been great national leaders of outstanding merit and stature, and I have not the slightest pretension of being one. Today I remember the day in March 1971 when I first entered the great chamber of Lok Sabha, where from one of the back benches I saw giants like A.K. Gopalan, Professor Hiren Mukherjee, Modulimai, Jyotirmay Bosu, H.V. Kamath, Indrajit Gupta, Y.B. Chavan, Jagjivan Ram, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Chandrasekhar, Indira Gandhi, amongst others. It was an ennobling and exhilarating experience. I also recall listening from the visitors' gallery the speeches of Pandit Nehru, Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, Mr. Nath Pai, and my father, N.C. Chatterjee, and other stalwarts, which left great imprint on my mind. We are all aware that Lok Sabha is the highest elected body in this country, and along with Rajya Sabha, necessarily occupies a pivotal position in our political system. Our founding fathers, after considerable deliberations in this great hall, decided to adopt the parliamentary system of governance, with Lok Sabha elected on adult franchise and a council of ministers responsible to the House of People. Our parliament has its journey for now for nearly half a century, and this year we are celebrating the golden jubilee of our independence. Many opinions are expressed about the role of Indian parliament and about its ability to find solutions for the people's problems and its capacity to espouse the urges and aspirations of the common people of the country, a very large number of whom still have to struggle hard for their very sustenance. On a perceived notion that the Indian parliament has not been able to play its due role, in some sections proposals are being made for having a presidential system of government. There is a view which I humbly share, that in the context of our country, there can be no better alternative to the parliamentary system of government. And what is needed is an attempt to remove the deficiencies and shortcomings, if any, than to change the system as a whole. Concentration of power in one hand has not helped us in the past. Our primary functions, no doubt, are legislation, debate, discussion, and decision in issues of national importance, and enforcement of the executive's accountability to the people through their elected representatives in Parliament. I remember having had the privilege and the great opportunity of listening to debates and discussions of highest standard on national issues, and nearly half of the time of the House was earlier devoted to work of legislation, while nearly 30% of the time was utilized for discussions on financial business and the remaining time for enforcement of the government's accountability. Substantial changes have come about, not only in the composition, but in the matter of time utilization. We are nowadays being faced with criticism about our failure to maintain decorum, and the Honourable Speaker rightly reminds us that the whole country is looking at us. It cannot be said that such criticism is totally devoid of substance. A substantial part of the proceedings of the House are now being telecast, and the people are able to watch how their representatives are functioning inside the House, for the running of which a very substantial amount of money raised from the taxpayers is spent. The Honourable Speaker often informs us, mainly in anguish, that he receives numerous letters from people all over the country, and particularly from young boys and girls, in which critical comments are made about the conduct of members inside the House. Obviously, it is for us, the members of Parliament, to take note of the feelings of the people so that we may endeavour to rectify the situation and the people's perceptions can change. We cannot lose sight of the fact that we are able to devote lesser and lesser time to some of the most important responsibilities that we have to discharge, namely consideration of the financial business and enforcement of the government's accountability. There have been years when we have not been able to discuss and scrutinize the demands for grants of more than three or four ministries, and as such, government expenditure of crores and crores of rupees remained without any scrutiny. In this context, I must refer to the great contribution made by our former Honorable Speaker, Sri Shivraj Patil, who took the leading role in the formation of departmentary related standing committees, which I believe have been able to discharge useful functions. These committees are still at a formative stage, but I am sure with the passage of time and with greater realization of the constructive role played by them, there will be more and more acceptability on the part of the executive. I hope in future the concerned ministries and the ministers will pay greater attention to the reports of the committees, which have so far been by and large unanimous. Reference of legislative measures to these committees have helped, I believe, in improving the content and form of the legislation. Over the years, we find lesser and lesser opportunity, primarily because of non-availability of adequate time to discuss fully legislative measures and also for debates and discussions on national issues. If I am not mistaken, more individual and local issues are today consuming a large part of the time of the House. 0 hour does not find a mention in our rules, but has become probably the most important business to many of us. There appears to be developing more and more attitude of, unfortunately, of confrontation than cooperation affecting the functioning of the House. I most humbly feel that when our functioning in the House has become matters of criticism and in some cases even of ridicule, and we find that even judiciary has chosen to make critical comments about our supposed failure to address to the basic problems of the country, there is necessity for introspection, and if any corrective is needed, it is we alone who can achieve that. Unfortunately, most of the basic problems of our people still remain unresolved. There is still acute poverty, unemployment, massive illiteracy, lack of social justice, lack of health care, lack of education, special problems for women and children still persist. People look up to Parliament for finding solutions for the same. We should constantly endeavor to see that the principles of secularism, socialism and basic unity of the people and the national integrity and probity in executive affairs and in public life are preserved and strengthened. We must assure that there never again in future should Parliament lose its assigned role under the Constitution by use of emergency powers or otherwise. It is the duty of Parliament to keep close watch on the executive and to enforce its accountability. Can we not select some of the burning problems affecting the nation to be considered and attempted to be solved in a spirit of cooperation than confrontation? Can we not have a national agenda for solution of these basic, some of these basic and urgent problems? There are rare and can be many issues of national importance which we can, within and outside Parliament, try to solve with a unified approach. I humbly feel that the time has come that for some of the basic problems we can have unity of purpose and also unity of action. Such approach has become vitally necessary, especially as it appears that the days of one-party rule have ended and the days of coalition governments have come. The composition of the House is likely to change in substantial manner, and I hope very soon we shall have women representatives in adequate number, namely one-third, so that the men and women of this country together can lead the nation forward. I hope the date will come sooner than later. I have the great honor to belong to the Communist Party of India, Marxist, and I can assure everyone, Rashtrapati ji, Uparashtrapati ji, Prime Minister and everybody else, that when I entered the House in 1971, I did not receive any instruction or mandate from our party to wreck the Constitution from within. We participate in the Parliament, being the highest public forum in the country, with all sincerity and commitment. It provides us with the opportunity to articulate and raise the problems of the common people, the problems of the working class, and the peasants and of the vulnerable sections of the community, and to achieve solution. The people have waited too long for redressal of their grievances. For that purpose, let us all resolve to uphold the glory of this great institution to which we have the honor to belong. Before I conclude, I wish to express my sincerest gratitude and thanks to all my colleagues in Parliament for their unstinted support, help, cooperation, and affection that I have always received, but for which I would not have been standing here today. I further wish to record most humbly my grateful thanks to the honorable presiding officers of the House for all the courtesies and guidance given to me and other members over the years. I shall be also failing in my duty if I do not express my deepest appreciation of the work silently done by the officers and staff of the Secretariat of Parliament, whose standard I believe is equal to the most efficient anywhere else. We have worked as a family, and let us maintain this bond in the days ahead. I also wish to express my sincere thanks to the media for the role they have played in upholding parliamentary traditions. I once again thank Indian Parliamentary Group, the Honorable Speaker, and you all from the bottom of my heart, and I shall never forget this day in my life. Thank you.